everyone for coming. And I'm Mariya Ivancheva. This is Agnes, guide. And we're gonna be, you know, moderating, framing a bit the panel, and you know, presenting very briefly the presenters, the participants before they speak. But before that, I just want to make a short introduction into, you know, why we're here, and you know, why did we come up with this, you know, extremely big panel title that has been an embarrassment, I hear, for some of us. So, against capitalism, nesting orientalism, conceptual ghettos, and self-imposed colonialism, regional emancipatory projects in the Balkans, West Balkans, Eastern Europe, Central Europe. Now, this comes from various different trajectories. One of them is that Agnes and I have been working together and separately on different periods of, so to say, self-colonization of the Eastern European progressive or, you know, like dissident movements, liberal movements as well, in which there has always been this kind of big dream of the West, and not only of the West as it came in its kind of neoliberal capitalist version of, you know, democracy, law and order, and free market, which we got in 1989 and around, but also in the sense of this, you know, gazing always towards the West for models. And this can also mean the Western left. So I think one of the issues that we're gonna touch upon is this kind of newly acquired understanding among the newly rising left in the region that is about we should start cooperating. And what we want to discuss here is a bit, you know, strategies, but also, you know, impediments to this cooperation, you know, constraints and new advantages that we have in the current situation to articulate a new politics on the left that is not only nationally bound, but somehow transnational, but also regional in the sense of, you know, regional cooperation that does not only gaze towards a Western, be it left or right or, you know, center or whatever. Now, another thing that has kind of been a topic that was under, you know, like that was underpinning the panel was that over the last year, quite a few left-wing forums in the East, in the region took place, even too many for one year, I would say, and I have been going to many of them. And one of the topics that somehow comes up, you know, beyond just regional cooperation is federalism. And I heard it as, you know, Balkan federalism, but I've heard it in different ways as well. And what's, I was just coming from Belgrade, and there were three young anthropology students who met me, we shook hands, and they said, so are we gonna manage to do Balkan federalism? So then I realized, you know, it's become very big at certain places. Though, you know, what is interesting for me in this Balkan federalism is that it's Balkan federalism. And Balkan is a specific designation of, you know, historical and geographic region that might or might not exclude or include, you know, certain geographical imaginaries, nation states, regions, and so forth. So this was very interesting to watch, to observe during different left-wing social forums over the last year, who are the ones that we invite. So we invite our immediate neighbors, usually, and maybe one state over. So in Romania, you would have maybe, you know, a bigger coverage of the former Soviet, you know, periphery, but you wouldn't have anyone from the West Balkans. In Hungary, you would have, you know, even maybe reach out to the Baltics, but you wouldn't go that far as, you know, inviting someone from Greece. In Greece, you wouldn't think of Romania and Hungary as anything, you know, close to the Balkans, and probably they wouldn't, you know, in some discourses, especially liberal ones, want to see themselves as Balkans either. So the what we were kind of trying to also ask here is how do these divisions that are often imposed by, you know, science, popular discourses, and so forth, how do they work on the ground with us? How do we see possible cooperations going, and what is the limit that we can foresee? Can we think of a, you know, post-Soviet you know, union, or is that too big to imagine? And so also, how do we think this vis-a-vis the new coming, you know, wave of migrants that, you know, somehow transverse these borders and make them much more fluid and make us think much more about, you know, something bigger than the Balkans, you know, leaving the usual territory of navel gazing, of, you know, and complaining about how worse our situation is, given that our own armies are fighting, you know, devastating wars outside, and that we are now part of the European Union, which is, you know, economic and military bloc that is destroying many countries in the rest of the world, and we might too willingly be complicit with it. So, along these lines, I would like to, you know, start with our presenters, and then we would have each of them speak for 10 minutes, or, you know, a bit more maybe, but we would try to keep it short, and then open the forum for discussion. So one last thing to say is that, you know, whereas, two last things to say. One is that I really would like also to have the question addressed, for example, of what a festival as Subversive is for us. You know, what does it mean to gather here together? What can come out of this? Is it productive? Is it counterproductive? And, you know, also thinking along the lines of the questions that I asked. And the second thing which we have been discussing is the question of strategy, because somehow it's like one of the biggest critiques towards our region from the left and the right, from around the world by now, not just from the West, but also, I mean, from Latin America and every other place that has been imagining some kind of socialist future, is that we never came up with an alternative model. You know, we gave up on the idea of, you know, creating something endogenous, and we're always, as Ralph Dorendorf was saying, you know, intellectuals left and right from this region would always meet in Oxford or London, but, you know, they would, or Berlin, but they would never kind of come together. So I think our generation starts meeting more, but, you know, what? How do we have a productive, you know, cooperation based on these lines? So with these words, I leave the floor to Matija Medenica from Marx 21 in Belgrade and the sociology department at the Belgrade University. Yeah?
Pardon, but it won't be translated.
No, but maybe someone can help. Is there any, what language do we need? Translation into? Anyone who can help? Okay, you might try. Thank you very much.
Okay, cool. Well, today the Balkan struggles under triple crisis of foreign debt, mass unemployment, and the productive sector. In reality, this is a crisis of dependency on European capital. Economic life is completely dependent on importing expensive European capital to cover the yawning trade and budget deficits, representing a vast plunder of national wealth to the European bankers.
You have to slow it down.
I have to slow it down. Okay. It will be a bit longer than 10 minutes though. With the crisis, the foreign bankers who controlled the financial system of the region stopped lending and the debt pyramid collapsed. Since then, Greece, Slovenia, Serbia, Romania, and Bosnia have been under the receivership of the Troika, of the IMF, EU, and European Central Bank, which has imposed, with the connivance of the official political class, austerity programs so savage as to provoke a humanitarian disaster. A new European war rages. Its aim is to make the Balkans and the rest of peripheral Europe pay for the debts of the northern European banks. I will try to show how our region has historically been passing through cycles of integrations into great power structures and what that meant for us. I will also give a few examples of economic mechanisms that have been at play in order for this pattern to work, in an attempt to offer a socialist perspective on the often blurred question of what position should the left take considering the EU membership. And that question is usually being posed against the background of much louder local right-wing forces being firmly against, even though they're always pro-integration into some other great power structures, such as Russia, for example. This is also to make the rediscover the idea of the Balkan Socialist Federation much clearer, in the sense that it was understood by the great socialists of our past, such as Tucović and Blagojev, namely as a strategic vision of another Balkans, as an alternative to various disastrous processes of integration, and not some sort of a common sense corrective plug-in for the already existing EU integration. If we agree on the simple fact that all of our countries are too small and too weak to smash the market and imperialist system, and on the need for the likewise small and weak new left in our countries to step out of the usually academic habitus, one of the crucial things we must do is offer a fighting vision and a refutation of racism and tutelage coming from both the outside as well as the inside, while unmasking the real reasons behind it. That is, in order to fight the apathy and despair with hope, so that we can inspire a real movement, a truly viable political force capable not only of interpreting our present, but also of shaping our future. In order to make my case as clear as possible, I will go often back and forth through history, so please bear with me. We were told that the primitive Balkan mentality is responsible for the ethnic conflicts of the past. European integration, market transition, and NATO military intervention were presented as the antidote to a history of failed modernization and so-called failed states. Now, after two decades of economic destruction and neo-colonial dependency, it is clear our problems are inseparable from the history of imperialism in our region. From the 19th century onwards, the decline of the Ottoman Empire created the so-called Eastern Question. This turned on the question of which of the great powers was to control both Southeastern Europe and the commercially and strategically vital gateway between the Europe and Asia when the sick man of Europe has finally been put out of his misery. Just as the collapse of the Ottoman power in Europe drew in all the great powers, so the ex-Yugoslav civil wars were the ground on which the great powers fought to take advantage of the collapse of the Soviet power in Eastern Europe. Pretext for great power intervention in the Eastern Question were provided by the frequent revolts of the Balkan peoples against the empire, the alleged protection of Christian communities and later national rights of the Balkan peoples became the favorite cloak of great power intervention, just as was the case with humanitarian intervention in the ex-Yugoslav civil wars. Such interventions allowed the powers to maintain their control over the region while laying the basis of future devastating conflicts between the Balkans peoples. The classic example is the Congress of Berlin of 1878, which was the author of the modern Balkans and would turn the region into the powder keg of Europe. After its victory in the Russia-Turkish War of 1877-78, Russia carved out an enormous Bulgarian state, which was shrunk at Berlin to less than half its original size by the other powers. Bosnia and Herzegovina, the scene of a peasant insurrection against Ottoman rule in 1875, were placed under Austrian occupation. Serbia, having been induced by Russia into war with Turkey in 1876, with the promise of gains in Bosnia and Herzegovina, was placed under Austrian protection in exchange for Russia playing a similar role in Bulgaria and grabbing South Bessarabia from Romania. So just as powers took advantage of Balkan nationalist conflicts to create their own Balkan clients, so the US exploited the ex-Yugoslav civil wars to create divisive neo-colonial protectorates in Bosnia, Kosovo, and up until recently Macedonia, farming out their administration to the UN, EU, and NATO. The Balkans that emerged from the Treaty of Berlin was fragmented into a patchwork of competing dwarf states dominated by the great powers and eyeing up the same territory in order to secure their viability. The fact that the new Balkans was cut from the diplomatic meetings of the great powers against the wishes of the representatives of the Balkan peoples who were excluded from the Berlin Congress taught Balkan nationalists a fatal lesson. Great power sponsorship, if not protection, were necessary if dreams of national unification and territorial aggrandizement were to be realized. In turn, the alignment of competing great power blocs with particular Balkan states and their territorial ambitions transformed the region into a powder keg in which local nationalist struggles acted as proxies and conductors for lethal imperialist rivalries. Serbia, blocked by Austria from expanding westward in the direction of Bosnia and Herzegovina or from unifying with Montenegro, was incited by Vienna in 1885 into a disastrous war against Bulgaria, a war designed to weaken Russia's position in the Balkans. The apple of discord laid on the table at Berlin was to push Serbia, Bulgaria, and Greece into an increasing vicious circle over multi-ethnic Ottoman Macedonia, laying the basis for the fratricidal war in 1913. The contemporary Balkans continues to be an arena where great power interests clash, since Balkan nationalists, too weak to impose their ambitions on their rivals, continue to look to great power intervention. The results are all too familiar and follow a historical pattern of divide and rule. For example, in the case of Kosovo, the price of intervention is that independent Kosovo is actually a US protectorate, while Serbia is a Russian energy colony. In the same sense, the independent Balkan states founded at Berlin were independent in name only. A number of conditions for independence were imposed by the powers. One was the signing of free trade agreements with great power protectors. Similarly, free markets were written into the Dayton Agreement that established a Bosnian state in 1995 and into the autonomous Kosovo foreseen by an abortive Rambouillet Agreement of 1999. After 1878, Serbia and Romania were obliged to sign over most favored nation trading status to Austria-Hungary. In the Balkans, cheap Western manufactured goods destroyed traditional artisan industries and even led to deindustrialization where there was actual industry, as for example in the case of Bulgarian leather and textiles. After 1989, the pattern was to be repeated, with a new opening to the global market leading to industrial collapse and mass unemployment. At the same time, the post-1878 Balkans became completely dependent on the export of agricultural products whose demand was inelastic and whose value was depreciated by international competition. As the founder of Bulgarian socialism, Dmitri Blagojev, warned in 1885, the Balkans was becoming an agrarian colony of Western capitalism. Economic dependency then became financial dependency. One condition of independence was that the Balkan states had to pay for the building of railways of strategic or economic interest to the great powers, and as well tender the work to foreign contractors. Railway building became a new form of great power competition to dominate the region, just as today the Balkans is at the center of pipeline competition between Russia and the EU-US over the supply of energy to Europe and control over Central Asian energy sources. As they were potentially military outposts of the powers, the independent Balkan states were also obliged to create standing armies, setting off an arms race in the region. To finance railways, armies, and of course the bureaucratic apparatuses necessary to administer them, the Balkan states were forced to turn to foreign loans. Very soon, these tiny, impoverished, and backward countries fell into a debt trap. The powers took full advantage and imposed supervisory bodies, which took over the collection of special taxes and concessions in Serbia, Bulgaria, and Romania. These were the IMFs of their day, operating in an analogous to the structural adjustment programs, which we of course see in the Balkans today. The concessions of the 19th century are today called opening up to competition, that is, handing over domestic state monopolies to foreign capitalists. This pattern of imperialist integration into the world economy has been repeated, albeit in a new form, in the Balkans over the last half century, and it is at the root both of the collapse of Yugoslavia and of the present regional debt crisis. Market integration with the EEC/EU, beginning in the 1970s with trade agreements between the EEC and Yugoslavia, a 10-year trade deal between the Federal Republic of Germany and Bulgaria, as well as technology imports by Romania, led these countries into a debt trap. The major weakness of market integration was that technical expertise was purchased with hard currency but sold primarily in the Eastern Bloc for soft currency due to both a lack of competitiveness and the closure of Western markets due to the EU trade barriers. Hence, in order to cover the cost of imports, the Balkan states were forced to borrow heavily from the Western banks. By 1989, Yugoslavia owed $20 billion and Bulgaria $12 billion, with payments taking up half of export earnings in the case of Bulgaria. In order to impose the market discipline necessary for the repayment of the debt, the IMF and the EU demanded recentralization of the Yugoslav Federation. As a reward for successful reform, the EU dangled the carrot of closer integration. In practice, this meant the alignment of the EU with the positions of Milosevic and Great Serbian nationalism, which sought to improve the competitiveness of the Serbian economy through Yugoslav recentralization. But the promise of EU integration also gave heart to the rich northern republics, which wanted to improve their competitiveness by ditching the poor south and joining the EU. In this way, the European Union was not only the agent of economic disintegration of Yugoslavia, but through promises of future political integration, accelerated its nationalist disintegration. In Tito's Yugoslavia, the opening to the world market from the 1950s led to the fragmentation of the federation into a set of competing and autarkic republican economies, and consequently from 1960s to the rise of republican nationalism. The attempts to use the world market to compete with the great powers merely led to internal economic fragmentation. In the Balkans as a whole, the attempt to industrialize to ensure independence from the great powers increasingly detached the region from dependence on the Soviet economic zone and led it into dependence on the EU. Now, the most important point to grasp here is that the entire history of the market in the region has been one of external linkages of dependency at the expense of internal linkages between our economies. This is best understood if we imagine the Balkans as a bicycle wheel, that is, if we imagine a set of spokes attached to the central hub, but having actually no connection among them. So like they all connect with the central hub, but they do not, they have no touch among them, right? This is why from an economic point of view, it has always remained in a semi-colonial economic relationship of poverty and backwardness, which in turn has opened it up to great power military domination. The current process of EU orchestrated regional integration, such as the Central European Free Trade Association, or CEFTA, does not aim to promote regional cooperation because that might enter into conflict with EU integration. In reality, the Balkans is being integrated as a captive market for Western goods and investments, reinforcing trends to deindustrialization and debt dependency. Hence, to talk about the transition to the market after 1989 ignores the fact that what is taking place here is actually a second cycle of debt economy. Debt has compelled the Balkan economies to open themselves to flows of foreign capital and finance, mainly receipts from privatization, in order to repay the same debt. The high interest rates demanded by foreign capital fed growth based on imports and customer debt, but at the same time destroyed industry and flung the region into an ever deeper debt trap than ever before. And this was no coincidence. The key to understanding this is the role of monetary policy in stimulating the speculative boom of the 2000s, especially the role of strong currencies. Models of indexing to the euro on one hand, and on the other hand, the currency boards. Now, on the one hand, high interest rates and strong currencies were designed to attract foreign credits, enabling the borrowing needed to pay for imports. On the other, the same strong currency regimes and privatization receipts were also responsible for destroying industry. Expensive money acted as a disincentive to investment in the real economy and made exports uncompetitive, hence rising budget and trade deficit resulting in the debt crisis we see today. The Bulgarian case also demonstrates most clearly that the model of financialized growth is in reality a mechanism of capital extraction by the Western banks. The currency board presupposes the full coverage and convertibility of domestic money into foreign currency reserves. Hence, in such a regime, the state no longer controls the money supply, as is the case within the Eurozone. Any deficit in the current account directly uses up currency reserves and thus contracts the quantity of money in the national economy, which has a negative knock-on effect on liquidity, prices, wages, and overall economic activity. Hence, the goal of monetary policy is to build up fiscal surpluses, which must be invested in the purchase of foreign currencies in order to cover the issue of domestic money. These funds are invested mainly in government bonds of other European countries. And so it turns out that the poorest country in the EU funded the richest at the expense of its poorest citizens. Bulgaria, like the rest of the Balkans, is a net creditor to the EU. To maintain the value of the currency in order to pay for loans contracted in foreign currencies, loans which cover the current account deficit and enable external debt repayment, the Balkan states have been paying for the debt of the rich Eurozone nations. In turn, the Eurozone banks are using the debt crisis to seize hold of new sources of public wealth, like the energy sector in Greece, Romania and Bulgaria are being privatized under the IMF structural adjustment programs. The regime of fiscal surplus requires as its counterpart a permanent austerity of public finances, meaning a vast transfer of wealth from the poor to the Balkan tycoons and Western bankers. And all the while, the debt economy destroys the industrial basis for growth and thus for escaping the debt trap. The strong currency regime is also a regime of convergence with the Eurozone, enabling the Balkan economies to pay for debt denominated in euros. But this only means that all the Balkan states are de facto members, or more precisely colonies, of the Eurozone, since they are no longer able to pursue an independent monetary policy. Forced to build up fiscal surpluses to repay debt, they cannot invest in industry to get their economies moving again, and so, just like Greece and the rest of peripheral Europe, must impose the most brutal neoliberal attacks on wages, pensions, and the social wage, and privatize all public goods. This is why the only way out of the crisis lies in a federation of our countries that would pull together and channel resources into nationalized industries in order to increase employment and raise living standards. We should demand a model of regional integration that does not depend on importing expensive capital and Western goods while exporting vast slave armies of migrant workers to pay for the resulting debt, but one that can become the basis for the development of public investment, industries and networks across the Balkans. The idea of the Balkan Federation enables us to link up the struggle against debt slavery with the struggle against imperialist control over the region. It is thus directed against both EU integration and Russian tutelage, against both debt and energy dependency. Therefore, it is not a nationalist, but an internationalist idea, directed against the alliances between the local capitalist classes and imperialism. Strategically, it enables the unification of all popular struggles across the region against our very own troika of IMF, EU, NATO, and Russia, into one single national and social liberation struggle of the Balkan peoples. Because of the alliance between our rulers and their external sponsors, the Balkan Federation shows us that our real allies are the workers, students, peasants, and pensioners of the whole region, and that in order to fight against the external oppressor, we must overthrow our little oppressors at home. Also, it is only the Balkan Federation that can create an internationalist alternative to the greater nationalist struggles over Kosovo, Bosnia, and Macedonia, struggles which enable the imperialist powers to divide and rule. Finally, only a Balkan Federation is a concept sufficiently wide to enable the national unification of all the Balkan peoples and allow them to live together in peace and equality. The Balkan Federation is our bond with the struggle of the Greek people against debt slavery and foreign domination. It is our own contribution to the destruction of the empire of European capital, which can open a new era in our region, an era where the peoples once again become the subjects of their own destiny. This is why we must once again talk about the Balkan Federation, but also embed it in all our aspects of our politics, so as to link it with our day-to-day interventions and start building its foundations from below, through connecting our struggles and placing them beyond the purely national framework. Thank you.
Thanks, Matija, for writing the manifesto of Balkan Federalism. I gave more time than, you know, like that, but
yeah,
I think we're all very, you know, excited to hear it. And now, Florin Poenaru is going to speak. He's from Central European University in Budapest and CriticAtac in Bucharest.
Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here. It's a fascinating topic and a fascinating panel. And it already started with this marvelous presentation, which I'm very grateful for because it serves as a really good basis for our discussion and for what I plan to say in this few minutes of my contribution here. So I will try to do to raise up two very modest questions, I think, but nonetheless they might prove to be important for our discussion here. The first question that I would like to very briefly address and just put it on the table for discussion is, what is the basis of knowledge on which we can claim this kind of regional status, like what is the source, what is the foundation based on which we can talk either of a Eastern European alliance or a Balkan alliance or a Eastern European Balkan federation and so on. What is the presupposition or the set of principles that enables us to think in these terms? And some of the arguments were already mentioned. I will just briefly highlight them. And the second question, strictly related to that, would be closer to the political mobilization part. And the question is, why do we actually need, in political terms, such a regional alliance? What is the role? What is the goal? And what can such an alliance achieve politically? And why not in other forms? So I will try to very briefly address this. So going back to the idea of a foundation of knowledge for such a regional alliance, the first step to take here, I think, is to make a crucial differentiation with the similar questions and the similar attempts made throughout history by the right, in various forms of the right in terms of historical positionality. Because we need to remember here two things, that these ideas of either Eastern European specificity as a region in transition, especially in the post-communist transition, or the Balkan region more encompassing, they're neither new nor necessarily politically progressive. In Eastern Europe, for example, post-communist Eastern Europe, the idea of an exceptional trajectory of the region came out from the conservative dissident circles before and after 89, suggesting that Eastern Europe has a, and Eastern Europeans in general have a particular access, unique access to history because they went through the damaging of communism. Western Europeans can talk about it, Latin America can dream about it, but guess what? Eastern Europeans went through the devil. So they claim this superior knowledge, and for example in Romania, the case that I know better, you have an entire literature describing how Eastern European experience must necessarily be framed as this unique experience of evil. Devil in history. That's one way of putting it. So you just emerge out of that, and of course you can claim knowledge based on this, access to unique knowledge based on this. Of course, going back to the Balkan part, there is already older idea here. I will not go back all the way to 19th century, but also in 20th century socialism, for example, this idea emerged. Also in this kind of anti-Western, traditionalist, nationalist socialist kind of way, in which this sort of Balkan legacy was supposed to mix somehow with socialism, but not, for sure to counterbalance the Western decadence, the Western, I don't know, not necessarily even civilization, but this kind of almost protochronist kind of argument in which of course, the purity of the Balkan peasant, for example, will be counterposed to the superficiality of the German people who just lost all the kind of links with the tradition and so on. Yeah. All this were already there. So I think the first step to do is to basically make clear that we have nothing to do with this tradition. Then moving on this more positive ground, going back to the question of knowledge is, of course, and I am totally in agreement with your presentation and your basic ideas, that basically we need to look at the historical formation of these categories that we talk about. First of all, the easiest thing is to, of course, look at the area studies discipline and the way Eastern Europe, Southern Europe, all these mixtures came into being. That's the standard critical approach towards Western academia. But what's more to that, I think it's more interesting to look at the particular intersection of what's happening recently, recently meaning for a few decades now, the overlap between this kind of post-socialist Eastern European type of experience and the older idea of Orientalism. And what is specific to this intersection, I think, and I think it's crucial for what we discuss here, is the is a particular mechanism of culturalization, of imposing cultural differences and cultural hierarchies. Or to put it in more precise terms, it's actually displacing what we heard here, this kind of very problematic mechanisms of empire, colonialism, dependency, subordination, global hierarchies, and so on, as cultural difference. And I think here we approach one part of the answer of why we can claim some sort of Eastern European knowledge from the left or from a progressive point of view is precisely by identifying this cultural mechanism within the formation of the region vis-a-vis Europe as such, Western Europe, but Europe as a concept as such. Because what happens with this region, Eastern Europe or the Balkans or this overlapping zone, is that basically they were never... the discourse here was never one of ultimate difference in relation to the Western pathway, either modernity, capitalism, or whatever we want to call it, but it was something of an insufficient cultural development, not yet there. Eastern Europeans or the Balkans are not like this radical alterity in relation to the West, the, you know, like African or whatever. No, they're just not Western yet. Which unfortunately was taken later up by the socialist modernization, but that's something that I will touch upon later a little bit. So, and this idea somehow stuck that the real difference of this region is one of culture. So basically, if you do the right civilizational approaches, then you'll actually bring this region to a Western level. I think beyond the economic aspects and the political economic aspects of the transition, for example, the whole discourse is only about that. And it's, I would argue that it's actually emerging in the 70s in Eastern Europe, Southern Europe. This idea that we need to catch up with the West, but in very cultural terms. So basically then you have all this discourse of self-colonialization and imperialism that is internalized as a cultural difference. So I think the first way to do this, to claim this kind of knowledge, is to say, okay, this is not the case. This is total bullshit because it's not a matter of cultural difference. It's precisely a matter of global hierarchies, relations of empire, in which this region, as such, was immersed from the at least from the outset of capitalism onwards. If not, we can talk about that also. But it's probably besides the point out, if not earlier than that. But for sure, in the way Western capitalism developed, this region, yeah, just dialectical 5 minutes. Yes, I know. This region was involved in this power regime. So I think breaking this cultural hegemony and replacing these ideas of empire and global hierarchies would be a first step to do so. And I think, and that's the second point, very briefly, what is helpful in this endeavor is also the experience of, I don't know, not even how to call it, communism or really existing socialism or Eastern European socialism. Why? Because I think I mentioned already, even these regimes were problematic in the way they conceived the region and its development after the initial Leninist imperialist moment. Not only that they, all the subsequent regimes fell into this nationalist mode and socialism in one country and so on and so forth, but also they prolonged this and they set up on different bases this idea of cultural backwardness of the region that can only catch up with the West based on Western blueprints. We have to do the job and we'll be there. Of course, it never happened because the region continued to remain subordinated in global hierarchies. And it had a particular subordinated position within these global hierarchies, even though it's more convenient to talk about the two power blocks, Cold War and so on, which is more like this kind of military projection and so on. In fact, if we look at, and I will not go into these details, I'm writing about this in my own work, is what happened with the exact mechanism of how state socialism functioned. I'm looking at the Romanian case, and for example, if you look at the IMF loans, the austerity measures of the 1980s, the whole hierarchies of flux of capital, of markets, of the production of commodities and how they could circulate outside of the national economy, and so on, all these kind of examples point out not to this kind of almost equalitarian balanced world system, but on the contrary, a very subordinated one, and in very particular terms, imperial and colonial at the very same time. So I think that's a very important aspect to bring about this kind of socialist experience. Another reason for that being that what happened in Western leftist thinking, especially after 68, but certainly before that as well, is to relegate this kind of experience of state socialism or socialism, communism, whatever, to some sort of aberration of history. Okay, something was wrong with Stalin and so on, forgetting two things. That first, it was a leftist legacy that needs to be confronted openly, and I think that's what such a Eastern European perspective has to do and has the power to do, to confront it on a leftist terrain, this kind of problematic legacy. And second, they forgot to say that it's not what it lacks is that what happened in Eastern Europe, Southern Europe or more globally with this idea of socialism was a problem of capitalism, and you can't extract it, you can't take it out of that. If you want to do a proper global leftist analysis of the contemporary conditions, you have to introduce this into capitalism. Otherwise, you don't understand how it functions and how, for example, that's the problem, for example, I have with Harv, which I think he has some very good points, but I think he's so narrow-minded on the way neoliberalism emerged in Western Europe that it's impossible to connect with the way the socialist bloc in itself helped the globalization of neoliberalism as a doctrine. And I think this is missing, and I think that's something some sort of Eastern European knowledge can do. Okay, just because I think I'm running out of time, I will just move to the
second
question. I mean, why do we need this kind of alliance, regional alliance, in terms of more or less political? Why not, you know, just do the whole international thing as we, as good leftists should do? Jump straight to the international level, and I think basically we actually have to do that. So I mean, here I'm all for that, but I think there is also a little bit of a regional answer to that, and a regional or a positive argument to having this kind of forums, meetings, leftist, which I can probably explain a little bit at the end what leftist is and why it's important for our discussion. I think the first very brief point, and the most obvious one, is that basically such alliances avoid the two immediate traps: neoliberal cosmopolitanism, right? The big danger of the great capital, and of course, what is happening now in all of these countries in the region, the nationalism thing, very ethnocentric, very localized, ethos. So at least having this mediating gap and so on. But I think there is another answer to that, which is historical, and maybe it will look very sketchy, but I can go back to that if we have time later. If you look at the historical development of the region, from the moment of insertion to the capital relations of production, formation of the nation states and so on, the particularity of these societies, especially because they were very peasant in their background, what happened is that they never had a revolutionary bourgeoisie. In a sense, up until 48, when the communist parties take over and make this kind of top-down, very messy dissolution of previous relations, the entire ruling class of this region was extremely conservative. Even the bourgeoisie, even the industrial bourgeoisie, which was lacking and so on. So basically, the responses to this conservative bourgeoisie, if they happened, were also very limited in their nature. Either, for example, pre-war socialism, which was limited to a very narrow understanding of the peasant question, and based its understanding on socialism on that, or they were as well conservative. This kind of, you know, what we see today, also the elites are sold to the global capital. Of course they are, and you can trace that, how local elites were basically, and the structure of the local elites throughout two centuries already was determined by the structure of global capital. But this is not the answer. Of course they are subordinated. The question is what kind of response you can give to that, which is not, you know, this kind of very populist, almost agrarian kind of answer. So I think such an alliances can offer this shortcut to almost two centuries of political questions, how to offer a revolutionary moment that is not falling back into some sort of utopian tradition, or into this kind of populist game of let's fight the elites who are sold to the capital, but offer a genuine sort of revolutionary moment for our region. So I think that's these are the strengths, and I think that's something we should definitely look forward to.
So first, let me welcome again everybody to a panel that seems to me to continue the best positive moments of last year's Balkan Social Forum. So let's dwell a little bit in this positive moment that started very well with Matija's manifesto. And my presentation, I'll split it in two parts, and I will try to be brief and hopefully then to extract most of your reactions in the Q&A. And I'm going to split it in two parts, one shortly explaining my and our own historical, critical, revolutionary consciousness that we developed in relation to our common recent experience after 89. And then a concrete proposal that comes close to Matija's proposal, but it's a little bit different, and that comes also from a concrete experience related to World Social Forum. So first of all, let me say that I come from an understanding of what we call the post-communist transition, for which we consider this transition as a return to in Eastern Europe of two major long-term power formations in the history of the world, capitalism and coloniality. And that, in developing critical consciousness and resistance towards them, it is not enough to, if you develop only an anti-capitalist consciousness and anti-capitalist movements, then we risk of not reaching the political level in our movements and skipping resistance to places and situations in which it will remain simply resistance and not reinvention. And so, long story short, we can, from my point of view, we can understand the post-communist transition, what I call the post-communist colonization, as a process of gradual integration of former socialist bloc, first into the military structures of Western governmentality, and we're talking about NATO and Frontex, then into the economical structures, and we're talking about relations with the financial, international financial organizations, but not only, regulate or encourage the global capital. And then thirdly, integration into political structures of Western governmentality, and we're talking about the Council of Europe and eventually about the European Union. And what we are witnessing in the past years with the mass demonstrations, unprecedented, it has to be mentioned, it's a historical experience that it's unprecedented since 89, that we had popular movements rose up in Eastern Europe at the level, at the national level, in more than one country. We had it in Hungary, in Romania, a little bit in Croatia, also important resistance movements, that articulated not only a resistance against austerity and neoliberalism, but also a disenchantment with the European dream and a disenchantment with Europe. And that it's a moment right now for us to work also with that disenchantment, with these energies, and to see where it goes. Because, of course, we also have the ascension of right forces that have taken over use words like anti-colonialism in order to push these energies and frustrations into a nationalist direction. And so it's very important to understand that this disenchantment with the European Union comes from a historical experience that, as Florin put it, you know, brings a concrete wealth of knowledges, a concrete immediate intuition of economies, of systems of economy that are not centered on money, that have proliferated under before 89 in the real existing socialism. And here I'd like to radicalize a little bit what Florin said. Something that happened with Western scholars after 68 and most especially after 89, and we include here Zizek and Badiou and all our good guys, something that they never did, and it's a grave mistake and error that needs to be countered, is that while characterizing and buying into the description of real existing socialism as a failed project, what they did was they rejected and sent into forgetfulness the historical experience of the people. Because what happened before 89 is that no matter what the official ideology was, you cannot avoid if you study in detail what has happened, you cannot avoid discovering the fact that underneath official ideology, you had a proliferation of different economical systems, solidarity economies, friendship economies, economies of solidarity, care economy, different networks, social networks, and modes of production of value, which were not centered on money, but on social relations and a general production of value that was not capitalist and that was a phenomenon happening from bottom up. And that is a richness, a concrete richness and a knowledge to which East Europeans have immediate intuitive reaction, and that needs to be it offers power, offers resistive power. Okay, now coming to the concrete proposal, which comes very close to Matija. Matija made a great job in explaining the long-term play and formation of Eastern Europe as a semi-periphery and as a subject of the, well, hierarchies of imperialism and capitalist hierarchies of power. And one of the concrete things that we could do right now in our critical understanding of both capitalism and coloniality, and here we include, you know, a critique of what we call, for instance, the post-communist racism, which has emerged after 89 and it has taken many various forms and various forms. So what we could do is move towards a positive moment, going beyond the negative situation in the negative moment of seeing the domination, going beyond stocking our own political positions in relation to domination, whether it's capital or European Union or IMF or no, and going towards the positive alternative that we ourselves build. And that's based on a concrete wealth of knowledge, alternative knowledges that we have and have to further develop, as I said, but also on a concrete historical opportunity. The Western world and European Union has been redefined itself and the Western identity and Western power structures after 89, thanks to the fall and through the fall of Eastern Europe. If Eastern Europe now changes orientation, if it starts looking in other directions, then this could have, in the global transition towards whatever world we are going towards, this could have enormous consequences. And a concrete way of doing this is looking at Eastern Europe from where it is, looking at us and talking from our skins as from the South, from the global South. And here we'll come to the concrete proposal that we developed in the conjugation with comrades from Tunis and Malaysia and India at the World Social Forum, and where we organized this panel on called Eastern Europe and the Global South. And the idea is to start claiming back not only the non-aligned history and non-aligned historical experiences and all the cultural and economic relations that were developed along those lines, but to claim a political project from Eastern Europe of remaking and reforming Europe itself, and our own conception of Europe, decolonizing Europe, in other words. And one of the ideas that came forth in this panel, which was very wide and in which the participation was there were East Europeans, but most of the people participating were from Southeast Asia and from African countries that had traditional links with East European countries in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. So one of the things that came up was indeed the need to everybody agreed on the force and the power of the concept of Eastern Europe as seen from the South and in conjugation with the Global South. It has a power, the very concept itself, the name of Eastern Europe, because it all of a sudden claims a different history. It all of a sudden develops a counter-hegemonic mindset. It all of a sudden states a difference, that the experience of East Europeans is different from Portuguese or Danish, or you know, all the references through which semi-peripheral thought has been channeled and reclaimed. And so East Europe as a geopolitical, as a force, as a concept, and the need to move forward from this understanding that we have and from the resistances that we build and international solidarities towards indeed a regional internationalism that of whose basis we already have, by way of creating regional structures of Eastern Europe, regional, and starting to put our thoughts not only at the level of theory and historical analysis, but at the level of praxis and at the level of institution building. And the concrete proposal that I'm going to come up with, and it's similar but of course different with the Balkan Federation, is the proposal of the House of Eastern Europe. As you may know, in Cuba, this was an institution in Havana, that created in Havana with the purpose of developing Latin American solidarity links and Latin American consciousness. And it included, it was a revolutionary institution at its time. It still exists, but well, there's different problems. And it included, it had a generalist approach, all right? In the sense that it didn't go only for the social sciences, only for the culture. It rejected the epistemic divisions at work in our modern division of knowledge, and it worked also as a means of syndication, of getting together and concentrating resources and energies to in a regional way. The concrete examples, of course, it's not only book production, but encouragement of authors, circulation of authors, of critical ideas, and the development of what is called in Havana the the emancipatory paradigms. So encouraging philosophers and social scientists and artists and doctors to think within this framework of emancipatory paradigms, as opposed to thinking in a framework of development or modernization, yeah, or competition. And the proposal of the House of Europe, of course, the Casa de Americas, it's a state-funded institution in Cuba. How could it be otherwise? But I would invite you, and I would use the opportunity of the Balkan Social Forum, the Subversive Festival, as something that right now moves towards a different level. I invite you to think, each one of you, in your own situational condition, in your own countries, what possibilities of building, of placing, creating this regional structure, and then we're going to move forward. There are already international regional internationalist institutions that we have built independently. Now it's time to find them a home. One of them is what we are trying to do with CriticAtac from Bucharest, so a common platform of leftist groups, independent leftist groups from the region, from Eastern Europe, conjugated under the name of Leftist. And this should be a means of intervening in each one's local public spheres by way of publishing texts at the same time, distributing information autonomously about particularly important events in each one's public sphere, and generally syndicating our efforts in a common way. That would be this kind of projects. It, instead of being simply ending at the mercy of the existing funders and of the mercy of existing you know, sources of financialization, this kind of project should find a different home, and that could be the House of Eastern Europe.
Yes, my name is Tibor Mesman, and I represent a group of, from Budapest, a working group for public sociology. And I'm very happy to continue. I'm happy to be here, but also to continue on lines already stressed by Ovidiu. And I feel a bit bold to come up with emancipatory ideas. So excuse me in advance if I'm too bold. So basically, the major question, how I understand it, is to how to deal with self-imposed collective mental maps and how to recreate forms of cooperation and solidarity. To think about this question, I introduce another question. So how to make possible the project of self-liberation, a self-liberation which would require a kind of ideational action, which would act against individualizing ideology, or ideology which is driven by national or sectarian or more particular concepts. So I will come up with quite concrete proposals and ideas, and obviously this emancipatory project, as Florin was mentioning, should be knowledge-based, knowledge which is transmitted via education, but also, I believe, music and humor should be also used as much as possible. And these means should allow us to create new identities. New identities, but I stress here that this emancipatory project requires lots of unlearning, undoing, in order to make a jump forward. And I will just mention a few things which could be stimulative on these lines, very concrete proposals. What kind of projects can there be? So for instance, one idea is regarding the recreation of collective memory and rewriting alternative histories of the region is something what we lack and which there is plenty of things to do. And so my particular thing which I two main lines on these things is to think about, for instance, the history of worker discouragement, or to think about how capital accumulation was made possible in recent Yugoslav wars. But also to recreate some positive examples from the past, to think about institutions like the worker universities in Yugoslavia and what we can learn from these. So this is it. This is very short, but I leave to others and the imagination to think on these lines. Thank you.
So now I will give the word to the other panel organizer, Agnes, who has been silent until now, but she would speak a bit and then wrap up the session and give the word to the audience.
Actually, I would just wrap it up and then maybe the microphone comes to me again in the discussion. So thank you very much for all the presentations. So I think the first thing that we made clear through Matija's manifesto was that this region has been into historical cycles of being integrated into power blocks, which resulted in splitting them in conflicts, and then those splits and conflicts were used again to legitimate new integrations into power blocks, saying that these are low quality people who are savages and have to be civilized. And now the problem is that in the situation today when there is again a peak of one of one cycle, one such cycle, we would like to think about emancipatory politics in this region. And our question is how, with this kind of emancipatory politics, we cannot slid into the same cycles again. And one of the problems that we wanted to address, it was addressed through the speakers, was how actually emancipatory politics also are part of these cycles, how we tend to orientalize ourselves when we are trying to think of emancipating ourselves. Now, one of the programs that we established here was that we need to make the mechanisms of our subordination explicit. So before speaking of identities, mentalities, and such things, we need to speak about capital extraction and basic stuff like that. But we also made it clear that this would be not enough, because our subordination works on the identity level too. So we need to make the ideational and identity level emancipation too, which would be kind of a more complicated question, because we have the post-colonial tradition, but within Eastern Europe, I don't think we have such a tradition of emancipation, and it would be very easy to slid into the very usual cycles over and over again. And another problem that I identified, maybe it wasn't that clear, but I think Ovidiu touched upon it very highly, was that what are our chances to do this emancipatory politics institutionally? I mean, what are the forums that we meet upon? Who are the people of who make the language that we speak? Are those our people, Eastern European people? Are they leftists who speak from which kind of context? And this means two things. And one would be that we need to go global. If we want to emancipate Eastern Europe and imagine it again as part of a global history and not something lagging behind, and then we need to go global. And one thing would be to speak again and look at Eastern Europe from the global south as well. Another question would be that we need to establish the forums where we can speak for ourselves and not go to Oxford and get financed from the West, because that put some limitations on ourselves. And if there is a practical question that comes out of this panel, it is how we are going to establish the actual forums and means of discussion and the words of our vocabulary that we are going to do this through. And this is not just a local story. We spoke about the House of Europe and the leftist as examples for how to establish it locally, but the thing is that we cannot make ourselves an exception again. If we want to make a vocabulary for Eastern Europe, we will have to make Žižek and the others take cognizance of the fact that there was this historical experience of all these peoples that these countries are in. I mean, you can use a language in the Kino Europa that is so far from this experience, but then we want to make political change in these countries. We cannot do that.
Bite into the lunch break a bit, but we would have something like 25 minutes for discussion. So I would put it at the end. So I prefer if we collect a few questions.
Yeah. Comments.
Okay, so I'm Matija, I'm from Hungary, from Budapest. I'm an ATTAC man, I'm a member of ATTAC Hungary, but also very active in the social forum movement, mainly in the European social forum. So I have a quite long experience about the European social forum and what happened in the European social forum. And mainly the positions of the Central Eastern European people in participation, and also the voice of the Central Eastern European people. So the whole discussion here is very interesting and very good. I found this is the best place and the best occasion to start cooperating. Because in the European Social Forum and even in the World Social Forum, the Central Eastern European people are underrepresented, and not only in number, but in the topics and in the whole discourse. So I think this is the good point, the starting point for us to cooperate and to build bridges. And for the content, I fully agree with the analysis of with your manifesto. We have made our own analysis about the Hungarian situation and the Central Europe. So we have some publications on that also. So the sharing of information and to keep a close connection, I think this is the most important thing. So I would like to offer our cooperation and working together in this field. So I finish now. Maybe later on I can talk.
Yes, I will give you. I will stand up because it's very. I am a big emotion, you know, really, really big emotion. I am Monika Karbowska. I am from Poland, so we are almost all countries represented. And just, I want just say that for this moment, I am waiting 20 years. Really, really, I am 40 years old. I was. In the beginning of the 90s, in the student movement in Poland, and it was just, you know, therapy, shock therapy. And now I am really, really happy to hear what I have heard. It's really, really a big moment for me. I was just to say one thing, that it was in our student movement, a magazine called Międzymorze, from the Baltic Sea to the Black Sea. And it was a project to first unite the East European countries and after to negotiate with European Union or with West Europe. It was in this time, but after when the collapse of Yugoslavia came, it was incredible shock for us because Yugoslavia exists from the 1918. It means it's like when Yugoslavia collapsed, it was like you are returning to the 19th century. We will lose all our independence. It was something like this. It was symbol of the collapse of all. You know, that's why, yes, it was so big shock for us. And the third thing I want to say is that, you know, we were in the the World Social Forum in Tunis. Actually, I'm living in France, so I have contacts with the Tunisian revolutionary movement. And it's really a pity that I did not have information about your seminar. And my organization have organized a similar seminar called When Eastern Europe meet Africa in the World Social Forum in Tunis. But you were not informed at all about our seminar. It seems that Matthias has right. We must exchange information and maybe have some portal, internet site together.
Hi, I'm Vladimir. I'm also from ARC21, which is Matija's organization. That also means I'm from Serbia, and I have a feeling I can't be present in a discussion about the Balkan Federation without talking about Kosovo as well, because this is a bit of an elephant in the room, and I'll come back to that in a second. I want to emphasize how much I think that the Balkan Federation is an internationalist idea, not just from the standpoint of the Balkans, but of Europe and the whole world. I was recently in Bologna, and someone took me to see a plaque in the center of town, and that plaque thanked the partisans formed in Yugoslavia during the Second World War for liberating Bologna at the end of the war. It was an Italian division formed in the Balkans, in Montenegro, that then marched up through Yugoslavia and liberated bits of Italy. Now, why do I say this? I mean, it's such a long time ago and so on and so forth. Well, because actually the Balkans can be quite central to the liberation of Europe from capital at the moment. And the central question, just like back then in the Second World War, was the struggle against fascism. Right now, the key question is the question of the debt. And the Greek debt is at the center of the European bloody crisis. So if the Greeks default on the crisis, that's a big internationalist move that will open up the crisis in Western Europe as well. The French left and the Greek and the German left will then have a lot on their hands in a way that they don't yet have. So I think that's why talking about the Balkans and being proud of what we can achieve even more widely than simply in our own borders is a very important one. But I also think it's also important to remember that no nation can be free if it oppresses another nation. As a representative of a Serb organization, I just wanted to bring up the question of Kosovo, but also other places. There has to be a concrete response to certain nationalist questions. We can't just talk abstractly about we love each other and so on and so forth, because unfortunately, the Serbian government is trying to keep Kosovo, or to split Kosovo. It's trying to split Bosnia, which will have implications for Macedonia. And we all know what happened in 1912, 1913 with the Balkan Wars, what happened in the Second World War, and so on and so forth. A very concrete way of responding to this question, at least from the Serbian left, has to be that we respect the right to self-determination of the Kosovan Albanians. I hope Agwan will say a few words as well. The trouble being, the Albanian in the room, yes. At the same time, I also have to say that right now, the way Kosovo is Kosovo is not an independent state. And the most recent way that this has been, most recent agreement that has been reached, I think the Serbian left has to oppose. Because what it means is the establishment and concretization of NATO in the region. It's basically a statement of the only way we can solve this is by NATO staying there to police the Albanians from northern Kosovo. That's completely wrong. What we have to say is the Albanians have absolutely the right to self-determine, to leave Serbia, and to have and to kick NATO out. And this is the only way in which independence, real independence, can be gained and actually recognized. So that's what I would say. But I hope Agwan will continue this discussion.
I have a question about the
term orientalism. Which has traditionally been used to describe Middle Eastern peculiarities as defined by the West. It's most notable because the word Middle East is actually a Western tag. There's Near East and Far East. So, I mean, as the Orientalist scholar Edward said, express that Asian identity is defined by the West, could you describe your application of the term Orientalism as it applies to this particular context? Is this what you mean, or do you mean something else?
Let me maybe respond briefly, because it is part of the title. I mean, and I think it also expresses. So what we meant is not just Orientalism, though, Orientalism has been applied, for example, by Maria Todorova to describe the kind of peculiar position of the Balkans, as an object in the subject-object-object, triad, as being always, the part of the West that they don't want to speak about, and the kind of weird, not still West that we already spoke. But I think in the title, what's important is the nested Orientalism. That is another term, which means it is, I think, more specific for Europe, whereby you have, these belts that are usually related to nation state building and, also current developments, in which, like, you position yourself within two different, so you see everybody who's east from you as worse, as more oriental, and everybody who's west from you as less oriental. So it is, like me in Bulgaria, I can afford to see Turks as kind of a bit, out there, but I look up to Yugoslavia or, to Serbia, as, they're a bit more civilized. You go to Belgrade and, they have better buildings, bigger roads, and so forth. So this is something that is very much seen, for example, in the concept of Central Europe, the way it was redeveloped by dissident intellectuals as Milan Kundera, especially, in the 1980s, whereby he says that, Central Europe was the core of Europe, and if Europe, meaning the West, doesn't reclaim Central Europe and it ends somewhere with Hungary, they're lost because they have lost their ideational and identity core. Meaning, the West should liberate us, but, let's not go further down there. So this is the way we were using the concept in this particular term. I hope I answered.
I mean, the invention, the reinvention of Central Europe after any time worked exactly that way, distinguishing within Eastern Europe the Westerners from the ones who are like less Westerners.
No, just very briefly to answer to the question about Orientalism. I agree with what Mariya said. I think Orientalism has already this kind of meaning of expressing a sort of colonial construction of inferiority of the other, of the exotic other. And I think it's appropriate to use it in relation with the Balkans as well, or even with the Eastern Europe, like Larry Wolf, now he has this inventing Eastern Europe, I think, hinting in that direction in a sense. So I think it's a useful term to look at this global hierarchies in creating a difference, in creating inferiority, and creating this kind of civilizational gaps between the West and the rest, as it were. Do we have? I mean, you want to say something, but I also
I
want
can,
to.
I can do the thing, or it doesn't have to.
Okay. No, because I had some other points that I thought were interesting to address, but
from the other question coming from.
Well, regarding, hi, I'm Agon Homza. I'm from Pristina, the elephant, as you said, and so on. Well, regarding the agreement, like, it is really of crucial importance that we stop the or prevent the implementation of Thocic-Dacic agreement, because then there will be no way back from ethnically based solution if we'll get another Republika Srpska or a state within a state in Kosovo. Another thing, if you read this appendix, because what we have is like 15 points of agreement which were published that day, that historic night, but then now they're publishing the appendix, and it is interesting because NATO has no role in it. It is the EU police which will take care of, it's EULEX, another one, so yeah, it's one of the four missions, EU missions in the country, so okay, that's it. Gal, is it?
Thanks for these great contributions, presentations. My name is Gal Kiran. I come from Ljubljana. I don't know. I'm affiliated to Workers' Punks University and so on. Anyways, it's like one of these, like somebody said, the continuation of certain workers' university without workers or with cognitive workers in Slovenia. Anyways, one question I think that also already you raised interestingly is like this kind of criticism of, let's say, anti-Albanian sentiment in the kind of popular liberation struggle. But one element I think that Matija, you could maybe explore or say something, it's also this anti-Turkish element. There's like around First World War and so on. So in a way, of course, I agree with your, let's say, manifesto, and the Balkan Socialist Federation is like one of the entities that should be pursued, but perhaps it could be also renamed or like a little bit more inclusive in a sense, like it can be called to make a positive statement on Orientalism, Oriental Federation, or it's like, or on the other hand, or on the other hand, like a federation of exploited and peripheral countries of the world, of the global south. So it's like, you know, we can move from this from this identitarian prescriptions, or like where we kind of, like what you said also, risk of being reintegrated into the, let's say, national differences and so on. So this is perhaps one point. Then the other for you, Florin, I would really agree, or I really sympathize with your direction of bringing up the dissidents and this devil in history. And I think it's even worse to radicalize the point. This is one of the only kind of points that was really successfully integrated in the West by the Easterns, by the Eastern political elites, in the sense that today in Europe we don't anymore celebrate the day of anti-fascism. Russia is doing, the celebration with its own imperialist terms. And in Europe today, we are celebrating in August officially the day of totalitarian crimes. So it's like today, European Parliament has adopted that already a couple of years ago, where communism and fascism are equated. But you know, the stress is on the critic of communism. So this is the new Europe which we have to like kind of bring. So this is, it's even radicalized. It's not just Eastern dissidents, but this has become one of the mainstream ideologies. And then who else? I would say for the popular history, I completely agree. And there has been like pluralities of economies, but not to forget, there are also plurality of economies even now in post-socialist societies. But the other thing, we can even defend not only the popular history, but even the state histories, the some parts of the socialist state histories, which is one part what you mentioned, kind of non-aligned trajectory or non-aligned countries, the movement, and the other even like this anti-systemic moment in these socialist states, or like, let's say, worker self-management and stuff, which was supposed to dissolve the state apparatuses in order to kind of bring it to decentralize, so kind of communes and other workers' councils. So you have already basically reintegration of anti-systemic moment in the system. So this is something to explore conceptually, but also what one could bring it to workers, universities, but also other political moments that were happening, you know, in a very kind of ambivalent relationship between the socialist state and the worker struggle. Okay, sorry.
Yes, I just need to say we need to finish in like 10 minutes.
Oh yeah.
And thanks.
I have another point to make, and I will try to make it briefly. It is related to what we've been talking about before. And this is that, let's just not leave it aside, that this relationship of orientalism, self-orientalizing, self-colonizing, this mechanism, it has a very strong aspect of the way local power relationships work. So the fact that we are inserted into broader power hierarchies means that we have the local elites who are inserted in those hierarchies in the best positions, and they work to stabilize and legitimize this insertion. If we look at, you know, the way democracy is inserted as a package together with capitalism after 89, that democracy is an anti-populist term. I mean, the idea is that we are going to catch up with the West through harsh reforms that the people don't know that it's good for them, and whoever speaks for the people in this respect is an anti-democratic populist. So this is the democratic side. And then we have the nationalist side, which says that we don't have to ask the people what is good for them, because we know, because we are organically from the people. So you have this kind of unorganic, unrelated, uncontrolled elites who are inserted in the same power structure in different positions. And you know, if we look back at ourselves, what are we doing now, for instance, here or also in our daily activist life? I mean, if what we do is that we are trying to constitute a new left through being inserted in the European left through mostly their resources, because we don't really have our own, speaking that vocabulary, you know, a kind of an analytic and propaganda language that is produced in those contexts and is usually ununderstandable outside our doors, then, you know, we kind of are doing the same, and what would give our, you know, relevance in this respect would be if, you know, we would be speaking for organizations here who actually work with these kinds of people. What I wonder if we do.
If there are no, yeah, I would just have a few. Yeah. Just a few remarks on what has been said, because I think there are important points. I will start with the one about the
victory of this totalitarian paradigm in which actually communism is more dangerous than Nazism, which is completely forgotten. I totally agree that this is actually the legacy of so-called, in Rumsfeld terms, New Europe. And, but here we really have to emphasize the importance of anti-communism as ideology, which I think is again completely missing from this Western perspective on the region, and which is something that can be brought out from this region as like, what did anti-communism actually mean for this, and in terms of ideology and changing these perceptions and so on. So I think this is anti-communism should be brought back onto this agenda. Then also somehow connected to your point was this idea of renaming the region in a more positive and political ways, and I totally agree. I totally agree because I think the reason for such or the ultimate goal of such organization, political organization, should be in fact transcending these notions. I mean, it would be in the end basically to get rid of the notion of Balkans or of Eastern Europe or of I don't know what, you know, to actually transcend these categories which are themselves product of a particular capitalist global imperial dynamic. So I mean, for me at least, the goal for this mobilization would be in fact to transcend it. And now I would go back to some of the points that you raised, which, because I think they're also connected. It's this question, really, to what extent can we delink ourselves from structures of power or imperial structures? Because I see this idea coming out, and I think it's a legitimate one. To what extent is the left or the progressive so on reproducing some of the categories of the empire? I think it's somehow impossible not to. I think it's by necessity we will do it. I mean, even for the simple fact that we have to speak the language of the empire in order to make ourselves understood in this room, it's somehow inevitable. And I think that's somehow the challenge. Going back to these notions and to these categories, to make this effort to go through empire and these notions and somehow transcend them dialectically, and at the end, I think that's the real challenge. Sorry.
I now give the microphone. Sorry. Oops. Thank you. To quickly, Tibor. Every one of you has less than 1 minute.
So okay.
So I only wanted to follow up what Aggie said about the infrastructure, and you know, like, I believe in small steps and realistic steps, because what we learned from, especially me when interviewing workers about their history and about present challenges and how they see the present situation, is that first of all that we know very little. Then they then a specific, you know, like also negative history. When I mentioned the worker discouragement, there was a huge coercive apparatus which did not allow many things. For instance, in Yugoslavia, alignments between workers from Slovenia and Serbia or Croatia was not allowed. So this is one of the last things of and how this was done. So it's important to break out from these kind of parochial identities even, and to establish these emancipatory projects, and a very particular how, you know, like it can be a, you know, like a, either a film club or other kind of event where you bring in people and allow them to speak and to share ideas, so something like that.
Nina Sankari, European Feminist Initiative, member of the Feminists for Another Europe, from Poland. In 1 minute, very difficult. Share the same feeling of happiness to be here and hear this kind of reflection and analysis. But I have, my main concern is, then maybe there was already an element of it, how to make this reflection, this analysis, how to make it, to reach the people, to reach masses, to make them be our support, to be the actors. Then you were speaking about these houses, it's very nice, it's good for again reflection, analysis, etc. We have already something of this kind in Poland, Krytyka Polityczna, political critics, with Sławoj coming there, for instance. And the vocabulary for the new, for this reflection, for the rewriting history, etc., etc., new vocabulary, everything is there, but the street just in front of this house doesn't understand a word of it. So for me, a main concern is to think about how to make this language accessible to the people. So vulgarization of it, I don't know, the kind of those bande dessinée, yeah, comics, etc.
So thank you very much. I'm Vladan Jeremić from Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung from Belgrade, and I'm very happy to be here and to hear all this important conversation. And I think it's very important what Agnes, what you were telling about changing the language and transforming this and linking this new, let's say, production of language with the history and experience of the people in the real socialism, mm-hmm. like to extract the most important heritage of it. Like, for example, what is very important is what you, Ovidiu, mentioned, like another way of production, like concentration on the use value of production, not on surplus value, not on let's say concurrency, on growth and so on. To change the concept of growth to do a real social and economical transformation of the society. I think this is very important, and to link all these struggles with the histories of the real socialism, what we had in the sense of, for example, praxis philosophy that we were working on, or the heritage of self-management that our comrades here are also looking for, or the anti-fascism of the Europe. I mean, this is mm-hmm. this is actually what we brought more than it was existing in the West. Mm-hmm. So this is just a comment. Thank you.
So just thank you very much for coming. Now, just to wrap up and to say that, you know, our conversation doesn't end here. We have already been in a long conversation. Left-East is a kind of hosted at present by CriticAtac, Romania, at present. I mean, it is hosted there. It is where we want to, you know, we very much invite English language contributions that are then translated back into your own languages. So there are articles from ours that are already translated in 5-6 Slavic languages, just, or, you know, like Hungarian including. but then the other thing is that we have to really think of this, you know, institutions also in terms of like how do we bring this change, also small steps but also big steps. And I think just feel free. I mean, when you meet us in the next days, let's sit down and speak and discuss and think, and, you know, inform us about the next events happening in the region. Like we're gonna publish it there, and you know, let's carry on with this. That's it.
Yeah. I just need to say now it's 5 to 2, and lunch is until 2:45. So,
okay.
So you all know.
Okay. Thank you.